This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world.
Deborah Blake is an award-winning author of The Goddess is in the Details, Everyday Witchcraft, and all sorts of fascinating witch-related books. She's online at DeborahBlakeAuthor.com. That's Deborah with an H, DeborahBlakeAuthor.com. And we are going to be talking with Deborah today about something I just found absolutely charming and wonderful. The Little Book of Cat Magic, Spells, Charms, and Tales. We're not going to be shy about the fact that Deborah is a Wiccan high priestess. She's leader of an eclectic group called Blue Moon Circle. She manages the Artisans Guild, a not-for-profit artists cooperative shop, and works as a tarot reader and energy healer. She contributes to pagan publications and has an ongoing column in Witches and Pagans. Deborah, welcome to Dreamland.
Thank you very much for having me.
Well, it's a real pleasure. Let's first talk a little bit about you. You are a Wiccan high priestess. Is that correct?
That is true. I've been practicing for, 25 years, something like that, and have had my own group since 2004. A small group, nothing fancy for me. But yeah, I'm a witch, but don't worry, I'm a good witch, not a bad witch.
Oh, listen, I'm so tired of all of that stuff. Margot Adler, you probably know her name.
Mm-hmm.
Margot was a close friend, and she, of course, is the author of Drawing Down the Moon and some other books.
She was one of our very, very, very great leaders, really.
Yes, she sure was, and she was a wonderful soul, and she and her husband John and Anne and I spent many an happy hour together. They used to come up to our cabin in upstate New York, and
I live in upstate New York. What part of upstate New York?
This was in near Woodstock.
Oh, I'm a couple hours from there.
Where are you, if I may ask?
I'm in Oneonta, which is
I know it well. It's a lovely place.
Yeah, it's near Cooperstown for people who have no idea what else is in upstate New York.
Well, there's a lot in upstate New York, and interestingly enough, the craft is a big factor in rural New York, especially.
It's a little sort of under the radar. There are a lot of witches out here, but because there's no real organization, people don't necessarily know that. But, I have all these books I've written, and I sell them in the Artisans Guild, the shop I run. And I'm amazed by how many times people come up and say, oh, I love these books. You're Deborah Blake. I'm a witch, and I live, not too far from here. We're everywhere.
Well, and it's a very young movement, too. It's a young movement in many ways. And tell us a little bit about what it is, actually, because a lot of people, when they hear the word witch, they immediately associate it with all kinds of sort of
silly Hollywood stuff,
but not these listeners. This is a much more sophisticated group
That's good, because I like the sophisticated people. Well, interestingly enough, I was actually just chatting to my father, who lives in San Diego and who is not a witch, he said they had a big article in his local paper talking about how Wicca is the fastest growing religion in the United States and I think all of North America. And that's been true for a while. It's basically, Wicca is sort of a broad overview that covers a whole bunch of different paths and traditions. But essentially, what people who follow modern witchcraft do is they take some of the heritage of the witches who came before us, the herbalists, the healers, the goddess worshippers, and then they sort of put their own modern spin on it. And, of course, depending on what that spin is, you may end up with, people who are very organized, not that any of us are all that organized, or people who just go off, you know, in the woods by themselves and talk to the moon. But that's, you know, the one thing we mostly have in common is we worship both a goddess and a god, not just a god, and which was actually, you know, in virtually every culture you look at until relatively recent times. And we believe that magic is real, that it is an energy or a power that you can tap into to create positive change in your life and in the world around you. There are a few people who possibly use it for not so positive change, but they net my people, and I'm not going to talk for them. So, you know, those are the biggest things. We're very much an eclectic bunch of people. You get some witches who are not Wiccans. Wicca is sort of a specific approach or group of approaches. But paganism, modern paganism, is really a resurgence of the very old ways that most cultures looked at the world. And it's coming back because I think most of us feel that separation from nature and from the things that are very real, and we're trying to get back to it.
Well, you know, we're also trying to find our own souls, and you can't do that without nature. You
Absolutely.
Have to have communication with nature. And I don't just mean, you know, wandering through the forest and saying, oh, wow, how beautiful. There's a level of communication because consciousness is in us, but we are also in consciousness, and that is where real magic comes in.
Absolutely.
So let's talk a little bit about your experiences with real magic and what that means to you.
Well, first of all, I absolutely believe it works. I have seen some
pretty You're talking to somebody who knows it works because I've seen it too. Go ahead.
Yeah, but not everybody realizes that. They, you know, they see the make-believe magic on television and in movies, which is, hey, it's fun. I watch Charmed. I have no objection to, you know, to the fun bits of it. But real magic, you have to put part of yourself into it. You have to put your intent and your focus and do the work that goes with it. So say you do prosperity magic. You say, well, gee, I could really use some help with my money here. Then you have to go out and you have to do the work, too. It just gives you an extra boost. And sometimes it captures the attention of the gods or the universe or whatever you want to call it. And you get what you ask for. It's, you know, it really is a fascinating thing to me. The more you pay attention and the more you put out there, the more it happens.
Now, that's very interesting because this, what you're saying is repetition is important.
Well, it's just like everything else in life. Practice makes you better at it. You know, I mean, there are people who are perhaps more of a natural witch than others. You know, there is nobody who cannot be a witch. I think some people are called to it more strongly. I was a witch my whole life. I just didn't know there was a name for it. I just thought I was that freaky hippie chick that, you know, loved to garden and, you know, liked animals better than people. So, you know, yeah, practicing magic, just like practicing anything else, will probably get you to the point where it comes more easily, where you don't need as many tools to help you get your focus. You know, I used to do very elaborate rituals for every spell that I said. Now, most of the time, I stand in front of my altar and just say it because I know how to do it from years of practice. That doesn't mean that you can't, you know, pick up a really good book written by somebody with my last name and learn how to do it tomorrow. It's just you'll get better at it as you go along. But, you know, there are also people who have innate gifts just like you. It's sort of like music. We can all do music. Some people are going to be naturally better at it than others, and some people are going to take more practice, you know, to get better.
Right. Well, and there are some people like me who will never get better.
Well, you know,
I can't sing.
With people who are better.
Yeah. Free Dreamlanders, we are saying goodbye for a few moments and let these commercials work their magic on you, and they just may do that. We are talking, speaking of magic, to a prolific author, Deborah Blake. We're going to be talking about a way cool book called The Little Book of Cat Magic, Spells, Charms, and Tales, as we explore her place and her work in Wicca. We'll be right back.
A new world is coming. Whitley has just finished his book about what it's like to live with and communicate with the visitors. He's been doing this for the past 30 years, and since 2015, the intensity of it has exploded. Over the next few months, he'll be reading from it for subscribers prior to publication. So be among the first to know what living with them is really like, and what it will be like for more and more of us in the future. A new world, unforgettable.
Join our subscriber section today. Click on the subscribe tab on unknowncountry.com to place your order.
I've been a subscriber to Unknown Country from almost the beginning. I get information there I can get nowhere else on the web.
This is Whitley Strieber. Go to Unknown Country and click on the subscribe tab. Join us. You owe it to yourself.
We're talking to Deborah Blake. Her website, DeborahBlakeAuthor.com, D-E-B-O-R-A-H, author.blakeauthor.com. That's DeborahBlakeAuthor.com. We're going to be talking a little later about the little book of cat magic, Spells, Charms, and Tales, because it's a really lovely, beautiful way of engaging with your cat in a whole new way. And I can assure you, if you know cats, you will know that this book works. So, because they're very sensitive to this stuff, they don't have all of the sort of buffers and shields between themselves and real magic that we do. And so they just live with it. They live in it. And you can too. Anyway, let's get back. You know, we were talking just briefly about, you mentioned the fact that Wiccans worship two deities, and one of them, of course, being the horned god. And do you know, that is the oldest representation of anything that looks like a possible god is the horned god in a cave in France, painted on a cave wall 13,000 years ago, known as the sorcerer. I think that's mankind's oldest god.
It's pretty remarkable. There are also some really, really old goddess representations. They've found very, very basic pottery, you know, figures of this, sort of big-bellied, pendulous, breasted.
The Willendorf Venus, for example.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And there are other ones sort of like that. And you'll notice none of them are skinny little women. These are mother figures. They have all the curves of women, real women. Not that there's anything wrong with skinny women. That was one of those ones. But the goddess and the horn god go back as far as the history of human beings. They are an elemental part of our DNA, and it really was only when Christianity came in that they sort of got shoved aside, mostly as a political power play. You talk about the horned god, who, yes, was pictured as having like the horns of a stag or a deer, and they sort of took him over and made him into this devil figure, which didn't even exist until they did that, and which isn't in the Bible, which, sort of, I find kind of amusing. They basically were trying to push the existing pagans in power out of power, as these kind of things happen. And that was when witches and goddesses started to get this bad reputation. And before that, goddesses were worshipped in every culture across the world that we know of. And, they are, something that, if you look at human beings, they come in two sexes. And if you look at animals, except for some very tiny little critters, they come in two sexes. It doesn't make sense that a god would only have one sex, to me, anyway.
Especially, like, Yahweh is so cranky. Who wants to deal with a god like that?
Yeah,
a place horrible
guys.
Practical jokes on Job, and you know, it's just a real piece of work, basically.
Yeah, well, you know, it's been raining for 40 days and 40 nights here in upstate New York, so I'm starting to think maybe they were onto something. I don't know.
Well, maybe so, but you know, it's important, I think, and certainly it's the sensibility of my website and my life and the show, that we're open to all comers in the sense that everyone who has a path is going somewhere. And
absolutely.
And so that's kind of where I'm coming from with this. Now, you mentioned...
I have a friend who's a Christian, although she's got some pagan leanings, some witchy leanings. But she said to me something years ago, which I thought was the best way I'd ever heard it put. She said that she believes that deity comes to each of us in the way we can best connect with it. That for those people who can best connect with this masculine patriarchal god, that's the way he comes to them. For those of us who can't connect to deity in that form, we get the goddess, or we get the goddess and the horned god. It is all one entity. It is all one power.
It's one
but it
presence.
Comes to us in the ways that we are the most comfortable with, so that we can reach out and feel them reaching back.
Right. Exactly. I agree with you. I'm, and you know, interestingly enough, in my own case, I don't really have a deity connection personally. I have a very complex connection with very real presences on the other side, but I'm not going to go into that now, except to say one thing, and that is that one of those presences is my deceased wife, and she said something that I always like to repeat, I mean, after she passed away, that I think is important. She said, enlightenment is what happens when there is nothing left of us but love.
And that's wonderful.
Isn't that extraordinary? And finding,
it is.
I see all religious paths, real ones, as paths toward that aim, goal. And if your religion takes you away from that and tells you you should hurt others because they don't believe as you do, then it's not a religion. It's something else.
And I agree completely. You know, to me, if you really look at the teachings of Jesus, for instance, he was all about love. Everything
right.
that he taught was about love and enlightenment and about being your best self. And that's exactly what I believe in as a Wiccan, is love and enlightenment and being your own best self. To me, witchcraft is very much about using these tools, whether it is goddess worship or magic or enlightenment, wherever you can find it, to become your best self and to put your best energy out into the world.
Right.
And certainly, you know, are there witches and Wiccans who are mean, nasty people? Of course there are. There are also Christians and Jews and everybody else who are mean, nasty people. They are not the majority of that religion. You know, any more than Muslims are mostly terrorists. Of course they're not. They are mostly people who love their families and worship their deity in the way that they do so, and mostly try and get on with their lives like the rest of us. For me, you know, in all of these books that I've written, my main thrust of the book is trying to help people find their path to becoming their best selves.
Free Dreamlanders, we're going to take another little tiny, teeny, tiny break. And when we come back, we're going to be talking about, what about the dark side? What about people who practice black magic? What happens to them? Because everything that goes around comes around. We'll be right back, because we're going to go around and come around too. This is Whitley Strieber. It's Dreamland. We are talking today to Deborah Blake. her website, DeborahBlakeAuthor.com. We're talking especially about the little book of cat magic, spells, charms, and tales, but just generally also talking about her place in the world as a Wiccan high priestess of long, long standing practice. And also with about the whole idea of worship and religion and deity and what that all means in a larger sense. You mentioned just briefly in passing, before we get into the sort of dark side of it, that you have an altar.
I have three altars.
What is a witch's altar and what might be on it?
Well, you know, for every witch, you've got a different altar. You know, there is no specific, you know, we have no rule book. There's no rule book. That's one of the things that I love about modern witchcraft is you can basically create what works for you. My altars are all a little bit different. They tend to, the general altar, if you want to go, like the altar that I set up when my group is doing ritual, for instance, we're going to have summer solstice this coming weekend, depending on when this is broadcast, maybe last weekend, I don't know. But we're going to do summer solstice, and we'll have four candles, one at each quarter, east, south, north, and west, to invoke the energies of earth, air, fire, and water. We'll have candles for goddess and god. When I do a full moon altar, then I only have a goddess candle. Usually some sort of crystals or stones that may change depending on the work that I'm doing. Images that depict god and goddess. You know, I have a couple little statues and things. I have one particular altar because I'm an author. I do a new altar for every book I'm working on, and I put things that correspond to that book. For instance, when I wrote the little book of cat magic and when it came out and I wanted to, you know, sort of give it a little boost in the universe, I had all sorts of little cat statues and things, you know, little cat shaped, you know, gemstones and things on my altar. Some people keep an athame, which is the traditional witch's ritual knife. It's a double-bladed knife that is used not to cut things, but to direct energy, you know, if you're pointing at something. Often there's a chalice for the wine or a cauldron. I have a little miniature cauldron on my one altar in which I put notes about the things that I'm trying to work on. For instance, like if I, you know, if I'm making wishes for something, I will put a little note with that. Or like in the spring, I'll put seeds to represent the seeds of things that I want to grow in the year to come. There's usually a candle that is lit for whichever magical thing I'm working on. So say I'm doing prosperity magic, I might use a green candle. There are any number of things. I have one of my altars is actually dedicated to the cats I lost in the last couple of years, has their pictures on it and some of their fur and the little boxes with their ashes. I lost my mama cat Minerva, and then a year later her children, the giant gray kitty Mystic and his sister Magic the cat, queen of the universe, who was my familiar. So they all have a little altar in my bedroom at the moment that has things that have to do with them.
I've had a lot of magical cats in my life. And you mentioned the word familiar. We're going to talk a little bit about what a familiar is. I want to briefly tell you folks about a cat called Hunam, who was the familiar of a friend of mine, Lee McCloskey. And now Lee's not in a Wiccan at all. You don't need to be a Wiccan. If a cat decides that cat is going to be your familiar, you have a familiar no matter what.
Oh, yeah, cats pretty much make all those decisions for you. That's a well-known fact.
But when Hunam was, when you looked at Hunam, you were not looking at a cat. There was someone else in there, and someone very old and very, very extraordinary. It was no ordinary little kitty. This was a big deal in the body of a cat. And in fact, was a big deal as a cat. And the other cats in the household were very aware of this. And Hunam was clearly the king of this whole collection of cats. When Hunam began to die, he went to the pond in the backyard, and he would sit on the edge of the pond and look down into the pond, into his own reflection. And every once in a while, he would disappear and then reappear again. I'm not the only person who witnessed this. What do you make of that?
I just think it's the coolest thing ever.
Isn't it incredible? I mean, Hunam was really someone very special. And
yeah, it does sound like there was something more than cat going on there. Cats are so magical in and of themselves. And, you know, I am a crazy cat lady. I have no qualms about admitting that I've had cats pretty much my whole life. Don't get me wrong, I like dogs too. I have lived with dogs. I just, you know, am not allowed to have one because the cats would kill me and bury me in the backyard. But there are, you do meet those cats on occasion who seem to have a little something beyond cat in them. And I think it's because there is something about the nature of the cat. As you were talking about, there's less barriers between them and whatever else there is.
Right.
And this can happen with dogs. It can happen with other animals. I mean, I've known people who have had dogs who were something else.
Actually, my dog was like that. But go ahead.
Yeah, but I think cats, because they are so mystical in nature anyway, well, some of them. I have one really goofy one right now who he looks mystical and he acts like a nutball. His name is Koshka, and I call him my fluffernutter. He's a big sort of Maine Coon cat kind of thing, although I'm sure he's not a purebred because he came from a 25-cat hoarding situation with his sister. But he looks like this very glamorous and mystical cat, and he's basically, I actually think he's a reincarnated dog. He plays fetch. He's sort of a doofus. He's my fluffernutter because he's just fluffy and not all that bright. Magic, on the other hand, well, first of all, is an illustration of that rule, which you have to be careful what you name your cats. But she basically bossed me around from the first moment I met her. I found her and her brother and their mother and two other siblings at, which I restrained myself and did not get. They got adopted by other people. They were at a shelter, and I went to go look for a kitten because I had an elderly cat who was lonely because she had lost all of her other companions, but she was sort of shy and I didn't want to overwhelm her. So I was just going to get a kitten. And I was looking at the two gray kittens of this batch of four, and this little black ball of fur, they were, I think, probably about 8 weeks old at that point, muscled her way to the front of the cage and said, "Mew, mew, mew, mew," which was she very clearly was saying, "You can take any of my siblings that you want, but you're taking me. I'm going home with you. That's that." And, you know, yes, she did, in fact, you know, go home with me and had, you know, then spent almost 16 years bossing me around. And she was, in fact, the boss of me. She was the boss of her brother, who was huge. I mean, he was so big that when he came down my rickety farmhouse steps, the whole house shook. Mind you, that could be the house. And she was sort of a normal-sized 11-pound cat, and yet there was no arguing with her. She just did what she wanted, and it did become clear fairly early on that she was my familiar. I had never had one in all the years that I'd practiced witchcraft. I had cats that, you know, sort of hung around, but had never particularly involved themselves in my witchcraft. You know, they might show some sort of curiosity. Magic, on the other hand, for instance, when we when my group couldn't be outside, I do have a circle out behind my barn that we use when the weather's nice, which in upstate New York is about 3 days of the year.
Right. We have to, I hate to do this, but we have to take a little break at the bottom of the hour. We're at 29 minutes. So this will be our last little break, I'm happy to say, for a while. This is Whitley Strieber. This is Dreamland. We're having a wonderful time today celebrating the summer solstice, talking to Deborah Blake about cats, cat magic, witchcraft, and just about anything that we feel like fits in this fun conversation. We'll be right back.
You've probably heard the music for years. It's the theme song for Dreamland. But you may not know the name of the piece, The O of Pleasure. Or the name of the composer, Ray Lynch. Ray Lynch is a 3-time Billboard Award winner. Ray is also the composer of the platinum album, Deep Breakfast. Pandora calls Ray one of the most influential artists in New Age pop and adult alternative circles. For music that will move your heart and set your spirit soaring, visit www.raylynch.com.
War Day changed the way we think about nuclear war. Communion led millions to realize that they had encountered the visitors. Superstorm gave a word to the world that has become the byword of our time. The Key is among the most prophetic books ever written. And where can you get inside the mind that created all this? On unknowncountry.com, where Whitley's life stories, his powerful meditations, his books Communion, Transformation, The Secret School, and others are available in audio format. And so much more exclusive Whitley Strieber material. Join Whitley on the path to tomorrow. How? Subscribe to unknowncountry.com today.
Deborah Blake's website is deborahblakeauthor.com. That's Deborah with an H, deborahblakeauthor.com. The Little Book of Cat Magic is her new book, and soon we're going to be talking about spells and charms and just what it all means when you get a cat into your inner life. And you don't have to be a Wiccan to do that or believe anything necessarily one way or another about any of this, because cats can enter your inner life and become part of it if they wish. There's a great quote here. If you are worthy of its affection, a cat will be your friend, but never your slave, Theophile Gautier. That's so true.
I had so much fun finding the quotes for this book. You know, there's quotes in all the chapters, and my favorite was the Terry Pratchett quote, which was, "Thousands of years ago, cats were worshipped as gods. Cats have never forgotten this." And it is so true. It is so, so true. They still expect to be worshipped as gods and mostly get their own way because, you know, who's going to argue with the cat?
You know, we've had, Anne and I had so many things happen to us with involving cats and our cats. After they died, both of our cats came back. And when Annie had a near-death experience, there was one of the cats.
Now, did they come back as other cats?
No, they came back. I see the dead, and my listeners all know this. I've seen the dead all my life without really understanding it until the past 10 or 15 years. But I do. And the little Siamese Co came back right after he died and obviously had no idea where to go. And I was able to turn him, because there's a turning that's involved when somebody is lost in this level of reality, and it seems to them, from their perspective, there is nothing else but this, and they're kind of wandering around in a world that sort of doesn't work for them anymore because nobody hears them, nobody sees them. Like Annie said, after she died, it looks like everybody, you're all intentionally ignoring us. language. So,
yeah, I don't see the dead. I speak to them occasionally, not very often, for which, frankly, I'm grateful. Occasionally when I do a tarot reading, somebody will come through, or if I do energy healing, I'll get somebody who comes through. Sort of when I open a door to it, it doesn't usually happen, you know, spontaneously. And I don't envy the people to whom it does happen.
I don't know. I find it wonderful, and I've had many souls come looking for help, like Cody.
Well, and that is the great thing. He came
looking for help, and I was able to turn him and face him in the right direction. Then Annie, a few years later, had an NDE, and what happens? She's finds Co, and what does he do? He's scorning her because she doesn't know what she's doing or where to go. Just like him. Like it just typical,
oh my goodness.
Typical of that cat. I mean, he was a real piece of work. He was a lovely little cat. He was like a dog cat. He was a little boy's cat. He was my son's cat. So anyway, we've had our other cat, Sadie, who passed away, came in through the window of my office and got in my lap after she died, which is where she used to live. We wrote books together. In fact, we wrote a book called Cat Magic together, a novel.
Oh, there you go. Yeah, Magic, my cat Magic, used to help me write all my books, and especially the pagan books. She's actually quoted in many of them. She gives her opinion because she has a lot of opinions. And in fact, one of the things that made this book so special is it was the last book she contributed to, the last book where I share wisdom from Magic, which is, of course, my translation of what I interpret she would say. But she used to sit, well, she would sit by me pretty much wherever I was, but when I would do my writing on my laptop, I would sit on my couch, you know, I have a recliner couch, and she would sit behind me and sort of look over my shoulder and supervise, and when I sat at my desktop, she would sit lying next to the keyboard with her head right on the edge of the keyboard, which was less helpful than one might expect. And she slept with me every night. But for months after she passed, I would catch a glimpse of a black cat. Of course, she was a black cat. Her name was Magic. Sitting behind me on the couch, and I would reach back to pet her, not even thinking about it, and then remember that she wasn't there, except, of course, she clearly was there.
Yeah.
And I felt her in bed with me every night. Her brother, who used to sleep by my feet, I lost them within 8 days of each other a year and a half ago, which was brutal, losing them at pretty much the same time. But yes, for a really substantial time, they were really present. It's gotten less so. And I don't know if that means that they've moved on and, or if Magic has just decided I'm going to do okay without constant supervision and we'll show up periodically. But yeah, for those first 4 or 5 months, I have never in my life sensed cats that have passed as strongly as I did them.
My little dog when I was growing up was a little rat terrier called Candy. And we were very close, and we used to sleep in bed together. And in fact, before my wife and I were married, she came down to meet the family in Texas, and she said, "Wait a minute, you've already got a wife. Candy is your wife. Don't you understand that?" I said, "Well, she's a dog. I mean, she's my dog." And she said, No, you don't understand. You and Candy are married. But I'll marry you too, but you have to understand always you're going to have two wives. And so
life went on.
Candy died. And since then, Candy has been showing up in my bed just like your cat did. Mm-hmm. And I will be lying there asleep and sort of half asleep and petting Candy and thinking about, Candy and Annie was there as well. And, when Annie was still alive. And then I'd suddenly wait a minute, how old is Candy? And I think, well, wait a minute, she's a little terrier. She can't be 60 years old. And then I would wake up and she'd be gone. One of the first appearances of Anne after she passed on, she had Candy there with her on a leash.
Oh, that's so cool.
Yeah. So it's true with dogs, too. But now let's get back to a little bit about the actual practice of magic with cats. And why is it better with cats?
Well, it's not necessarily better. It's just another added layer, maybe. I mean, certainly people who do not practice magic with their cats are not worse witches or missing out on something. You know, none of the cats that I have now show the slightest interest in my magical practice, and my practice is as strong as it ever was. They just can lend a paw, as it were, and I do think they can add their own very special energy to the work. I was starting to talk about magic, the cat, and my circle. So when we practice inside, I have a round table we put in the middle of the living room, and everybody sits around it or stands around it. And we would know it was time to start the ritual because Magic would come into the living room. She would walk around the circle, always clockwise, greet everyone, and then she would either sit underneath the table, the altar table, or on the back of the couch and supervise. And when it was time for us to be done, she would walk back around the circle again and stroll out of the room. And we'd go, oh, okay, I guess the ritual is over. But she very clearly was in tune with the energy. She, you know, I believe she boosted it. And that's the thing about a familiar is hopefully they help you to, you know, take what you're doing already and they give it that extra little bit of feline oomph because they do have this connection with the universe that is a little bit different from what we have.
Well, in a sense, it's more pure because we have intellects and
right.
Our intellects kind of get in the way of that
well,
relationship.
We have self-doubt, which cats
right.
do not have.
That's very true. They don't have that gene.
Well, and we have that rational, you know, we are brought up believing, at least I was, I come from a very rational-based family. And, you know, if it couldn't be proven, then it didn't exist. You know, so we have to sort of get ourselves past that to relearn how to believe in the things we can't see. As children, we all believe in things we can't see. But then our society teaches us, oh, that's not true. And we have to reteach ourselves, you know, the stuff we knew instinctively as children. But cats know that stuff instinctively without any of that silly practicality getting in the way. You know, if you've ever seen a cat staring at a corner and you can't see anything, but the cat clearly sees something, well, I would believe the cat.
The life I've lived, I know the cat was right because we
exactly.
had that. I wrote the book Communion, which you probably know, and we had what I call visitors in our house a lot. And the first sign was the cats would react; they would see.
And oh, absolutely!
You would know that someone was here. The cats sometimes they were very scared of these individuals, and once
yeah, and if the cat's scared, that's a hint.
It is a definite hint that you know there's something scary there.
Right,
you may not feel it because of all your filters, but the cat
right.
doesn't have those, and so maybe it's a good idea to be careful when your cat is scared.
Yes, if the cat says this is a problem, it's a problem.
Yeah, once I had these knocks on the roof. Of our cabin that is I mentioned in my book Transformation, and the cats reacted. You know, cats when they're scared, their tails will puff up.
Right.
Both cats were lying on the back of the couch when it happened, and the entire cat puffed up, all the hair. I never saw anything like it.
They do that if they are very alarmed or about to fight something.
Yes, and so they were very alarmed. So I was alarmed too. And it never went anywhere beyond where it was, what happened. There was a lot of information in it for me. But at the same time, the fear of the cats told me that maybe this does not really belong in our reality somehow.
Mm-hmm.
Now, let's talk a little bit more deeply about magic and what it is and where it comes from, because people have been doing magic for a long time. And when did you start realizing that magic was real?
Well, probably when I started studying Wicca. I mean, I was a psychic since I was a small child, so I always knew there was something. I wouldn't call that magic exactly, but I always knew there was something beyond what most people were sensing. I didn't necessarily know exactly what it was. Mostly we thought I was crazy, which is also true, but has nothing to do with me being psychic. But, you know, I think I always had this sense that there was something more, but it wasn't until I started studying witchcraft under my first high priestess that I realized that it was a thing, that there was a name for it. I mean, obviously, you know, as a kid, I was fascinated by magic in books. You know, I loved, you know, books about witchcraft and books about, you know, paranormal things and fantasy books. And, you know, I read every fairy tale there was, you know, on the planet. But as an adult, you know, as I began to study this, I realized that magic was simply a name for this power, this energy that we can tap into that is in the universe that, you know, my belief is someday we will be able to measure it. You know, not that long ago, people thought electricity was magic. You know, people, because they didn't have a way to measure it, because they didn't have a way to quantify it, it seemed incredible to them that lightning could come down from the sky. Now we know what makes lightning, and it isn't, you know, magic. It's weather, and it, you know, is caused by certain, you know, physical phenomenon. And I think that we're eventually going to discover that just like many of the other things, like they can now take pictures of auras, which they couldn't do originally, they're going to find a scientific way to, you know, put some facts around magic. For now, we have to take it on faith because we can't see it. We can see the results of it. But I think it is just another natural energy that is out there that we, you know, if you believe in it, you can tap into it. It's one of the things I use to try and explain it to people who are not witches is it's a lot like prayer. You know, they have proven that prayer works. There are scientific studies that show that if you have a whole lot of people praying for somebody, whether or not that person even knows it's happening, it makes a difference. Putting magic out into the universe is much like sending out a prayer. You're basically saying, this is what I want, pretty please. You know, here's what I'm willing to do for it, or, you know, here is my energy that I am using to feed this. And so, you know, if you want to really look at it in an uncomplicated way, it's the same kind of energy that makes prayer work. Some of it comes from deity, some of it comes from us, some of it is maybe free-floating, you know, out in the air where we can't see it, but it is there and it is real.
Yeah, it is real. And making it real for yourself is not, it's not just saying, I believe this. There's something else there. And that's where your magic comes in. And you can do it or you wouldn't have been doing this for your life, which you have. It works for you or you wouldn't quit.
That's true.
Yeah. So what is...
Although it doesn't work all the time.
Oh, of course
not. One of
the
things that I try and tell everybody is, don't expect to ask for things and get them every single time. You know, just like the rest of life, you can put a lot of effort out, and sometimes things don't go the way you want them to, and sometimes you can ask the gods for things, and the answer is no. You know, just because you say, well, you know, pretty please, can I have this job? Maybe they say no, but of course, sometimes that no is because that's not really the right job for you, or it's not the right time. Or, you know, something better is coming along, and if you got the thing you asked for, you wouldn't have this opening for this better thing. Maybe you're not ready. So sometimes you don't, you know, You can do magical work for all sorts of things and not get it, and that doesn't mean that magic doesn't work. It just means that there's some other reason, which doesn't necessarily mean you didn't do it right. Sometimes you didn't do it right, but right. Sometimes it just was not the right time for that.
Well, you know, white magic, I think, supports your life plan, and black magic seeks to change it and it derange it. And maybe somebody else's black magic would do that. I don't know.
Well, it's possible. I think there are a whole lot fewer people out there practicing what you would call black magic than most people think. You know, as you mentioned, what you put out is what you get back. And most of us who practice magic do believe in what they call the law of returns. Some people call it the threefold law and say that whatever you put out, you get back three times. So if I were, say, going to curse you with pimples, well, I don't know why I'd do that, but then I might get herpes. You know, why would I do
right.
that?
Yeah.
Most magical practitioners understand that there is a price to be paid. And if you're asking for something that's good, you can pay the price by doing good things for others. If you are asking for something that is not good, well then, you know, you may be paying in an ugly way. Now, there are people who don't believe this. You know, there's a huge range of people who call themselves witches, and there are some folks who believe that they can get away with things. I think they're wrong, but you know, let's face it, in the world, there are a lot of people who think they can get away with things, and sometimes they do for a while. But there, I have, in my whole entire life of meeting up with witches, never, ever met one that I would consider to be a black witch. I know a few who have practices that I don't necessarily approve of. I know some people who use hexing, some very well-known people. I don't know if you're familiar with Z Budapest.
Yes, I am.
Yeah. She is well known for working with women and hexing rapists. Now, I get it.
I get it. Can you tell us just a little bit about her? Because I'm sure my listeners don't know who she is.
She was one of the founders of modern witchcraft. She is very much a feminist witch. I think she was involved in the Dianic witchcraft movement, which was women only. I think they've now expanded to include men, but they were basically reclaiming their power as women and worshiping goddess by herself. And she was a very influential, still is an influential figure in the Wicca community. She has very definitive ideas of how things should be done, which don't necessarily agree with everybody else. I've met her. She's lovely. But I was actually at her birthday party at PantheaCon a number of years ago. But she believes in hexing as a tool to punish the wrongdoers, in particular rapists. My issue with that, and I definitely get the temptation, is first of all, you must be absolutely sure that you've got the right person. Now, in many cases, she's working with women who are telling her, this is the person who did this to me, and they do have the right person. But you are also still doing something that puts negative energy out there. And I believe, and this is just my own personal belief, I believe that the cost for that is too high. Now, you can do bindings. A binding is not a hexing. A binding is sort of neutral magic, which hopefully will keep this person from doing such a thing again. And then you can pray to the gods for justice and hope that they will take care of it. I don't argue with anybody who wants to do hexing. That is a personal choice, and some witches do and some witches don't. You know, I know that in the current political climate, there are people who are tempted to hex those who don't agree with them. The problem with that is these are all human beings, none of whom to themselves are evil. You know, none of them look at themselves right. as the villain in the story. And
yeah, that's very important to remember, folks. Nobody normal sets out right. to be the villain.
Yeah, I mean, there are people who are broken and twisted and pathological, and they certainly may set out to be evil. But your average person who you disagree with, who maybe is on the other side of the political spectrum or religious spectrum or anything else, they see themselves as perfectly reasonable. They have family who loves them. They think they are doing all the right things, just as you in your life think you are doing all the right things. Now, are you both doing all the right things? If the things you're doing are completely different, maybe so, maybe not. I obviously think the people who disagree with me are wrong. but that's, you know, I am not going to do magic to prevent that, because I think that that is a place where you're crossing the line. Will I do magic to increase peace and harmony in the world? Yes, I will. Will I do magic to make my life and the world a better place? Yes, I will. Because that's not doing anything bad to anybody else. That's just putting out my intention that things will get better. And if everybody did that, you know, it would be a pretty remarkable thing.
Indeed, indeed we would. Living with cats, I had been told that the training procedure with cats was difficult. It's not. Mine had me trained in 2 days. Bill Dana from your book, a great quote.
And it's so true. I learned a long time ago that there are certain areas in which we can come to agreement that if I do the things that they want, they will perhaps stay off the counter most of the time, or at the very least jump off the counter as soon as I come into the room, look at them and go, are you supposed to be up there? Now, Magic the Cat, who was, you know, her full title was Magic the Cat, Queen of the Universe, because she did not believe that those rules applied to her. She knew perfectly well what they were. She just thought they applied to her brother and her mother and the other cats in the house, and that she was above all that. And frankly, she mostly was. But yes, you can actually train cats. I had a cat who was having behavioral issues, and in an effort to change those behavioral issues, I trained her to respond to a clicker and to jump on a stool and sit in order to get a treat. And she would do that every single time. And eventually I stopped using the clicker and I would just say up, and she would jump up, and I would say sit, and she would sit, and then I would give her the treat. Now, mind you, she wanted the treat. If I had been doing it for something she didn't want, she wouldn't have bothered.
Right.
Did not change the other behavioral issues at all, because what she wanted was to be an only cat. She wanted to be queen. And in fact, until I was able to find her another really good home with someone who had no other cats, she continued to do all sorts of things that I didn't approve of, including beating up the other cats. As soon as she got what she wanted, she was the best behaved cat you ever saw in your life. She never got on a counter again. She didn't cause any problems because all she wanted was to be an only cat, which just goes to prove that, yeah, we're not in charge of them. It's just, you know, but there are things like in my book, I do have spells for helping you to, you know, maybe persuade your cats to get along better with the other cats.
Yeah, like the spell for a tranquil household.
Right, yeah. Which, you know, guess where that came from. And spells to keep cats safe who go outside. My cats that I have these days do not go outside because the place where I live, there are coyotes, there are barn owls, there are cars that drive very fast down my, you know, country road.
Yes.
But, you know, I have in the past had cats that went outside. I think it's much better if you can keep them in, but if you can't, then there's, you know, spells to protect them. There's spells for, you know, healing and for keeping them healthy, spells to, you know, guide you to the next cat you're supposed to have. I actually just got a cat on my lap, Ember, who is gray with orange bits in her, hence the name Ember. Yeah, so there are all sorts of useful practical spells, because as a witch, I'm I'm not a terribly esoteric witch. I'm all about the useful and the practical because that's just the kind of person I am. So all of my books, no matter what, that's hence the title of many of them, The Everyday Witch, whatever they are, The Everyday Witch Spell Book, because it's all about how you live your life every day. You know, I'm not just a witch on the Sabbaths and on the full moons. I'm a witch every day. It's how I walk my talk. And so my books tend to be, you know, pretty practical. So yeah, you've got spells for, you know, integrating a new cat, spells for finding the perfect cat sitter. I gotta say that one worked. You know, spells to ease the stress of a move, you know, that sort of thing. Spells to discover your cat's real name.
That's a very, very interesting question. The uh-huh. cat's real name. We're coming up on a break, and normally the third half hour of the show changes into some. We usually have a different guest. You were going to be that guest, but frankly, we've had so much fun. I wonder if you could stay for another half hour.
I can do that.
Oh, good. Well,
I have multiple personalities. I can be as many guests as you like.
Well, great. Because now the Free Dreamlanders, we're going to say goodbye now. And I do hope you think of subscribing to unknowncountry.com. It's a rich treasury. There's nothing quite like it in the world. So Free Dreamlanders, we're signing off for you until next week. We're going to be talking to Jeffrey Kripal, the co-author of Supernatural, who has an incredible book out called The Flip. And then we're going to be talking to New York Times reporter Leslie Keene about the work she is doing behind the scenes and at the New York Times as probably the world's leading reporter on UFOs and strange phenomena, who has brought that incredibly into the mainstream simply by her long-standing effort to do so. Thank you very much for being with us, and do join us again next week.